Well, joining us now is former Australian Senator Lee Rhiannon. She is the commissioner of the International Observers Mission, which conducted the study on the 2022 Philippine polls. Commissioner, good afternoon from Manila. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you.
All right, so let's begin with your conclusion. In that report, you said the evidence is just overwhelming. The national Philippine elections clearly failed the people of the Philippines. You went on to say that Marcos Jr. and Vice President-elect Sara Duterte were not elected legitimately. What is your proof for saying this, Senator?
Well, look, the proof is extensive and it comes from a very thorough work over many months. As well as our seven commissioners, we had 60 observers from 11 countries. They worked very thoroughly on the ground from the beginning of April. They were documenting the campaign, looking at how the vote proceeded, and also the aftermath in many areas. And what we found was deeply alarming. And that's why we concluded that we cannot say that this was a fair, free, and honest election. That's why Marcos Jr. and Sara Duterte are not legitimate candidates. And now suits many Western countries, and they will be obviously at these big celebrations, to make out that it's democracy. But this isn't democracy when there's so much violence. Many people were not able to vote. Many scandals to do with the actual voting process. This is very well documented in our report, and we've made many recommendations.
But here's the thing, Commissioner, how do you then reconcile your findings with the reality on the ground even prior to the elections? You talk to people here and they would say even prior to May 9 that their vote is going to go to Marcos Jr. You have survey outputs that time and again have confirmed this reality. And of course, on the day of the election and post the count, you got to talk about the 31 million vote mandate for Marcos Jr. and 32 for Vice President-elect Sara Duterte Carpio. Add to that the foreign governments now recognizing the incoming administration. How do you reconcile your findings with that reality?
Well, firstly, just to start with why some foreign Western governments are swinging in behind the new regime. It's not actually surprising. Let's remember when the soon-to-be former president, Mr. Duterte, came in 2016. He pledged to shift his country's foreign policy away from the United States. His first trip was to Beijing. He then said it's time to say goodbye to Washington. He then flips and comes back to the United States. And considering the Philippines is in such a strategic geographic position, the US is now courting the new regime and the new leaders. So it's not surprising that they came in behind the whole voting process. But then let's remember, and yes, you've given us figures there, but what we've also found from our studies is the number of people who were unable to vote. Like, there's 1.7 million registered overseas foreign workers. Only 480,000 of them were able to register. Then there was a loss of almost 900,000 votes in the Bayan Muna party list, and I do apologise for my pronunciation. And then there's a whole question of the electronic voting. Like, this is a major international scandal. It's run by this company, Smartmatic, and it's very questionable if it should have even been given the contract, considering it's less than 60% Filipino-owned, which is inconsistent with constitutional requirements. But the COMELEC, your electoral body that runs elections, brought them in. And a number of people have actually been charged in terms of data interference and system interference. And I think it's very worrying the way that was conducted when you find out that many of the voting machines did not work. A number of the votes had to be left with the staff at the polling booths, which then removes the secrecy of the ballot, which should be integral to any democratic process. So the vote is under a huge cloud, and that's why our findings are really very adamant that this is more than a problematic election. It is actually not legitimate.
But you're also saying that there must be an overhaul of the election system. Your local partner also here is saying that it's not going, your findings won't be able to overturn the votes, but that more importantly, there has to be an overhaul of the election system. So if you're going to start off with that, where do you begin?
Oh, look, yes, that's what we really want to talk about. And we acknowledge, and I just saw your earlier report, the celebrations are about to occur. And yes, many people see them as illegitimate, but they're going ahead. And so we're realistic. So we have a comprehensive set of recommendations. We're very clear that the military must be excluded from all aspects of the electoral process. The party list system became very controversial in this election, and it does need to be returned to its original constitutional intention, which was to represent marginalised and underrepresented groups. That really is essential. And if any leaders who have been elected, as I would argue Marcos Jr. and Sarah Duterte have, want to rebuild their reputation, they would start with many of our recommendations. The issue of vote buying needs to be addressed. I really don't think anybody's denying how rampant it was. I was shocked at the reports and the evidence we were receiving. The huge amounts of money, the figures that we received was it was between 300 and 4,000 pesos per candidate was what was being handed over. And often people were collecting money from more than one candidate. That's not democracy when money's being thrown around in that way. We need a free press. There needs to be substantial social media reforms, and there's a complexity there, we acknowledge it. But the issue of fake news is extraordinary. And the other one that I am very interested in, and again, we know who the new leaders are, is how do we address the issue of political dynasties, which is now really another big factor that clouds the electoral system in the Philippines, where a few families have so much control, not just at the top level, but right down through the voting system.
Well, finally, Commissioner, but finally, you know, we're just counting hours. In fact, just about 24 hours before the inauguration of President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. How do you think your findings are going to affect his incoming presidency?
Look, it has to affect the incoming presidency. The struggle around human rights reforms will be ongoing. And the future needs to ensure that we address not just the electoral issues, but the living conditions of people. I think a very big one needs to be that the government needs to look at food prices, because there'll be otherwise rising famine, as there could well be in many parts of the world. So there's social and economic measures that need to be addressed, as well as the very fundamental electoral issues that I've outlined. And again, if the new president and deputy president are sincere about honour of working for all the people in the Philippines, they will address many of the issues that we've taken up.
Former Senator of Australia Lee Rhiannon, who's also the Commissioner of the International Observers Mission, we appreciate you taking time to talk to us this afternoon. Thanks again. Take care and you
Thank
keep
you.
Safe.
Thank you.